Take a good look at him. He's one of the great prizes of American hunting. But South Dakota is where he feels most at home.
South Dakota has made its reputation and its heritage based upon wild birds. Wild birds in wild, great places to hunt. Now we go to pin-raised birds.
Whoa.
What's happened, of course, is when you push, when people push commercialization of the resource, or they promise in their fancy brochure that you come to ABC Lodge or you come to the ABC Hotel Motel in such a place, and you'll have, quote, guaranteed pheasant hunting. Well, once you move it out of hunting, which is never a guarantee, and under the North American model is not a guarantee, and you move it over in here to the assembly line production of pin-raised birds being released out on this ground out here, what you've done is you've appealed to a whole other aspect of this hunting, and it's shooting. They want to shoot.
The Capital Journal reported in 2017 the state was adding almost 20 more private shooting preserves. But the growing popularity of preserves isn't the only thing changing. Cooper sees fewer wild pheasants when he hunts. He says there's a disconnect with the state tourism material promising plenty of pheasants.
But the only place you could guarantee that is now, is over on the pin-raised birds side of the ledger. On the other side, no. And to my way of thinking, the vast majority of people I hunt with, they won't go to a preserve because they recognize that the hunt is the critical thing that they like. And it's a little bit like kissing your sister when you're going over into the pen-raised birds area.
Pen-raised pheasants are bred on a farm, like chickens. Producers typically sell the birds to a shooting preserve. Efforts to promote the sport come as questions continue about the state's wild pheasant numbers. In 1978, South Dakota reduced the wild pheasant bag limit from 3 birds to 2. The move came because the state's pheasant count had dropped to 4.5 million birds. John Cooper says that was a wake-up call.
That's alarming economically to South Dakota. It's alarming from the standpoint of our hunting heritage. Right now, we're probably in that 4-5 million bird area.
But that's hard to prove. The state stopped counting wild pheasants, called the brood count, in 2019. State employees would drive the same routes every year and count the number of pheasants they saw. They would extrapolate a total population estimate from that. In early 2020, the South Dakota Game Fish and Parks Department teamed up with the State Tourism Department. Together, they developed a marketing plan to increase pheasant numbers in the state. Each department is investing $350,000 a year on the effort through this year. An executive summary on the program also touches on why the brood count ended. Quote, to ensure that South Dakota is not unintentionally deterring hunters from coming to our state based on the media headlines reporting of low bird numbers. Chris Hesla has been executive director of South Dakota's Wildlife Federation for the last 24 years. He says the state's rationale doesn't add up.
They threw it out the window, and now they're asking people, you know, producers who make money off of pheasant hunting, they're asking them how their pheasants are. Well, what are you going to say? They're great, the best I've seen. I just think we're going down the wrong path. We need to keep science in our wildlife, and we need to manage it for everybody.
Hesla says successful pheasant seasons are now defined by the number of hunters who buy a license. SDPB requested an interview with the governor for this story. The governor's office referred us to Game Fish and Parks. After repeated requests for an interview, GF&P Secretary Kevin Roebling replied to questions via email. He says the tourism effort was never just about an increase in pheasant license sales. Quote, the marketing efforts are more about investing in the storytelling of what South Dakota has to offer and ensuring there's a space for everyone to participate. In his email, Roebling says conservation programs are the focus to ensure abundant public hunting opportunities. Quote, there are many pheasant hunters who wish to enjoy do-it-yourself hunts, where they can explore the various public hunting opportunities in South Dakota. Governor Kristi Noem wants to convert more land into habitat through the Second Century Initiative. She spoke virtually to a conference earlier this year.
So my goal is to really grow that program and continue to get more dollars in there, open up more opportunities for more acres to be covered. And it has seen some big benefits for folks. And the more people see it out there, the more they're willing to invest and willing to participate in the program too.
The effort is enrolling acres, but critics say only some are enrolled in parts of the state that could be prime pheasant habitat. And those acres can be harvested for hay every other year. John Locken sits on the GF&P Commission, a group appointed by the governor to oversee the department. He says habitat creation is a primary focus.
One of the great tools that we have is the habitat stamp now. We're able to access some more money to facilitate those programs, and that's been a wonderful thing for the department.
The habitat stamp is something hunters purchase with their license. The revenue goes directly to improve and develop more public land for hunters. However, people buying a license to hunt on a preserve are not required to buy a habitat stamp. Wild bird hunters say that is especially unfair at a time when they are seeing fewer wild birds. Recent administrations have dealt with the question of low pheasant numbers differently. The 2013 pheasant brood survey showed a 64% drop from the year before. It also reported a 76% decline from the 10-year average. Those statistics caught the attention of then-Governor Dennis Dugard. In response, the governor called together a summit.
But with more than 500 people registered, I'm sure we'll have people coming and going throughout the day, but I'm going to be here the whole day.
The day offered discussions, expert insights, and plenty of feedback from the public. John Cooper helped write the summit's final report. He says the Nome administration appears to have ignored the findings.
How far are we willing to subvert what basically is the traditional hunting ethics and the enjoyment of hunting, and how much do we put it into some kind of a Disneyland? That's it. For me, that's what it boils down to.
Cooper says some of the preserve hunters don't know they're shooting at pen-raised birds. Just outside of Winford, South Dakota, there's a 1,200-acre shooting preserve. Trevor Ryle started the operation a few years ago. He says preserves and public land hunters are not in competition.
As far as bird counts go, I would say that we actually help the bird counts because we're required to replace every bird that gets shot, and there's no way that we can actually control where the birds go when we release them.
Ryle says some of his customers confirm the reality of wild bird numbers.
We're starting to get people that don't normally go on preserves that are starting to turn to us because they're not finding the birds on public land.
And he empathizes with the hunter who can't afford to stay at a preserve where most packages range from $200 to $2,000 per person.
Not everybody wants to spend money to go hunt on a preserve. I can definitely understand that. For some people, it's pretty expensive to go shoot three birds.
South Dakota hunting preserves are not required to clearly identify pen-raised pheasants with a marker. And according to Pheasants Forever, the odds of those birds surviving their first winter are dramatically less than wild birds. For many hunters, preserves now play a role in the annual tradition. Just like wild pheasant hunting, those who go after pen-raised birds contribute to a multi-million dollar industry. Trevor Ryle says South Dakota shooting preserves also play a role in conservation efforts. The land is home to many species. Deer, ducks, butterflies, and bees all take advantage of habitat that could otherwise be drained, plowed, and planted. For South Dakota Public Broadcasting, I'm Joshua Heyer.